Good afternoon, Tim Ostendorf. Tim Ostendorf? Can't even pronounce my own name. Tim Ostendorf, baritone and innkeeper at the Inn at Crystal Lake in Eaton, New Hampshire. I always have to start off with a little plug for the inn that I own in Eaton. But today it's going to be all Mozart, and I'm going to see how far I can go without completely driving myself crazy, because I realized I don't think I've ever done anything from Così fan tutte, which is I think is my favorite opera. If you had to hold a gun at my head and say, what is your top three? Number one would pretty much always be Così, then maybe Manon as number two, and then maybe Anna Bolena, depending on my mood, maybe Don Giovanni. I don't know, but definitely number one would almost always be Così fan tutte. And now, surprising, because of course, Joan Sutherland, my favorite, never sang the role. She did do a fair amount of Mozart. She did The Countess, of course. She did, let's see, flute. She did Pamina, the First Lady, and a few performances of Queen of the Night. She did Elettra in Idomeneo. She would have been wonderful in Lucio Sillo or Mitridate. What's that? The Aspasia. She would have been wonderful in that, where she could just kind of stand and sing or park and bark. That would have been wonderful. All that fabulous coloratura would have been right up her alley. But instead, today it's going to be all things Così fan tutte, not all things, just one thing Così fan tutte, multiple times. And of course, what's the most fun aria in the first act is Come Scorio, like a rock. And so I have 13 different versions. These are the different full CDs I have of the opera. And then these are all different recital discs with just the aria, the big aria, Come Scorio, like a rock. It's one of my absolute favorite operas. I find it very emotional, very human. Some people think it's very silly, but I won't go into too many details about the plot because it is very silly. But the raw emotions, especially in Act Two, are just, to me, are some of the most realistic. I find Così fan tutte and Carousel, the musical's Carousel, the two of the most realistic of their oeuvre. But anyway, won't get into Carousel right now because it's all about Cozy. And so this is the first act aria. We're going to play the entire thing 13 times. No, we're not. Instead, I'm going to start off with the self-proclaimed queen of Mozart, Helen Kwan, who does all sorts of wonderful things on here and does various, like in from Figaro, she does The Countess and Cherubino and Susanna, things like that. But here she is. I'm going to play her so you can get a little feel for most of you probably. If you're watching this, you probably know this aria, right? Well, this is the recitative that leads into the aria, and then I'm just going to play a little snippet of each of these sopranos and or mezzo sopranos. Interesting, right? So here we are with Helen Kwan to start us off. For those of you who do know this, she is being wooed by these two sisters are being wooed by the opposite boyfriend. The boyfriends have pretended like they've gone off to war. They come back disguised as Albanians, of course. Excuse me. And they're trying to woo the other's fiance. And so sometimes when there's some beautifully lovely phrases in that opening recitative, and sometimes they make it a little too beautiful. She's supposed to be like spurning them. She's in mock shock about these guys, and yet they're somewhat titillated as well. And so I've also read that the aria itself is sort of a mock presentation of one of those opera seria arias. And so there's lots of big wide leaps and things like that, and it's very over the top and very dramatic and all that sort of thing, but in a comical way. And so anyway, I find it interesting when they sing it a little too beautifully, because it's supposed to be silly and over the top. Like a rock. Immovable, immobile. And then wonderful high B flat, and then down the octave to a middle B flat, and the fermata is on the lower B flat. But you'll see some people do it a little differently each way, and I like it done a little different each way. You know what I'm saying? So who's up next? Let's see.
Stop.
And so next we have a mezzo-soprano who has been known to sing quite a few soprano roles. That's right, we have Cecilia Bartoli. Is it Bartoli or Bartoli? Usually the accent in Italian would be on the second to last syllable, but for some reason I think it's Bartoli, but maybe it's Bartoli. I can't remember. I should know, especially since she's been around quite a long time. Like, this is recorded 1994. I didn't realize it was that long ago. And she does all the, you know, she does both the Countess and Susanna. She does Zerlina and Elvira. And I know she's done a lot of those, all those roles on stage in Così. I think she's done, I know she's done all three, Dora, Bella Fiordaligi, and Despina. And that's one of those discussions you have in a lot of those opera discussion groups, things like who, what soprano has sung all the female leads in Rosencavalier? And, you know, a lot of them start off with Sophie and then eventually move to the Marshalin and maybe do Octavian in there, things like that. So a lot of Mozart lends itself to that, especially both soprano and the baritone roles. For example, that wouldn't be surprising for in Don Giovanni for one singer in the course of his life to have sung Mazzetto and Leporello and Don Giovanni, or in Figaro to sing Figaro and the Count and who's the gardener guy, and then the other guy, depending on, you know, their bass baritone-ish, kind of all in the same realm of that. So I love me my Mozart as a baritone because I can do lots of different roles in all those things. But anyway, this is Cecilia Bartoli singing her version of Come Scoglio, and I love that her, that mezzo quality she has adds a little richness and excitement. Cecilia. And she's definitely gone outside of her mezzo world. She's even done things like Norma, which has caused quite a, I don't know if it was really a scandal, but quite a sensation, I guess, because it's very outside of her. And she doesn't have a very big voice as well, so that was a kind of a big deal. And who is up next? Perhaps a Slovakian soprano? I don't know. I'm just throwing that out there. And so next up we have my other favorite diva, besides Joan Sutherland, of course, Edita Gruborova, a Slovakian soprano who is still singing, and she's, what, 71, 72, something like that. And this was recorded not too long ago, so she was well into her late 60s, I guess, when this was recorded. I'd have to look up the date. I don't see it right on the case. I'd have to pull out the book. But anyway, not to everyone's taste, but I love her voice. I love her sound, perhaps a little bit past her prime to do this particular recording of all Mozart, but lots of it is still glorious. And she did do a film version of Così in the role of Fiordaligi, and so she is lip syncing herself. I think it's a wonderfully beautifully filmed film of Così. So definitely seek that out. It's definitely of its time, done in the late 80s, I believe. But here's a little Edita Gruborova. Maybe not to everyone's taste, not necessarily her best recording, but the fact that she can still do it, I think, is pretty impressive. I wish she had a little more point to the sound in this particular recording. But who's up next? And next we have, I believe she's English, Amanda Rucroft. I don't know whatever happened to her. She doesn't seem to, I don't know if this was done back in 94. And this was sort of her calling card for a while, if I remember correctly. She did this everywhere, and there's a DVD, a filmed live production of her doing Fiordaligi, and it's really quite wonderful. Beautifully beautiful costumes, and I think it's really stellar. And she has this great sort of hooded quality to her voice, as we say, kind of covered sound that really appeals to me. And she's one of the ones that I love the fact that the high B flat, and then it goes down to the low B, lower B flat, and there's a fermata on the lower B flat. And she holds the high B flat just a little longer than a lot of the other ones does. She puts a kind of a little extra fermata on the one that doesn't have a fermata. I love that. And then there's these two little, after the fermata, there's these two little eighth notes that a lot of them will hold a little bit longer on the D C down to the B flat. There's only one soprano that I remember that almost sings it in time after the fermata, if that makes sense. And you'll hear her in a little bit. So who is up? Next one's very exciting. You might have to indulge me. Might have to do a little extra on this next one. And so this next one is quite a surprise. I haven't listened to this in a while, and I may have to spend a little more time with this CD. It is the Greek soprano Agnes Balza, and I've always loved her sound. There's no messing around with her, and she does some quite amazing things on here. Mostly stuff that is normally sung by a soprano, and so she does some Maria Stuarda. She does this big scene from Così. She does Lady Macbeth's two big scenes from Act One, and then the big sleepwalking scene from Act Four. Big scene from Les Troyens by Berlioz. And so you're just gonna have to indulge me, because I have to play the whole recitative as well, because I find it exciting beyond belief. Would help if I queued up the right track, right? Just little details, Tim. And so there is no doubting that character, as far as that she, there it's balls to the walls, Balza, Agnes Balza, balls to the walls. I mean, it's just There is no like soft caressing of the line. To me, it just fits that character perfectly. Like, don't mess with me. And so here is her opening bit after that glorious recit. Swoopy coming back off that high note, but like I said, I'm gonna have to listen to that whole CD later. I'd forgotten how wonderfully exciting her sound is. And so, oh, I have another surprise for a very different reason. And the next one is surprising to me in a different way because it is the one of my favorite leader singers, the glorious Elly Ameling, a beautiful Dutch soprano. And so not known for her opera roles, she did very, very few of them. And the fact that she has this wonderfully meaty sound for this, I think is just wonderful. It makes me wish she had done more opera, and specifically Mozart. I think this is really quite fine vocalism from Miss Ameling. Right? Who would have thunk it? Fantastic. Just wonderful. And so who's next? Maybe another soprano from Gruberoverland, perhaps? And so next up is the glorious, beautiful Lucia Popp from the same country as my beloved Editha. Of course, she passed away much too young in her early 50s, but she's one of those wonderful sopranos that started off doing the high-flying stuff like Queen of the Night and then moved on to amazing Pamina. Susanna is one of her best roles, that wonderful recording with Thomas Allen and Sam Raimi, I think it is, and Kiri Takanawa, of course, and Frederica von Stada as Cherubino. But here she is. I don't know if she ever did this role, but this is from a whole 3D set of all different recordings, and just such a beautiful sound. Loved her voice, even if that high B is just a tad on the brittle side. Next up, a wonderful American soprano. Who could that be? And here we've moved on to Phyllis Curtin. I have a soft spot in my heart for her. She was the dean at the school, BU, when I was a student there, studied with her out at Tanglewood. Just a wonderful American soprano. I've done various videos on her. This was from a live recital from 1968. Oh, the year I was born. That's right, I turned 50 this year, it's true. And so I'll tell you about that another time because I have some kind of fun plans scheduled for my 50th, but that save that for another time. But here is Phyllis Curtin, and I won't say this is one of her best recordings, but and she has kind of a funny thing that she does with her vowels. You may not be able to hear it in the opening of this, but nonetheless, here's the glorious American soprano Phyllis Curtin with her opening of Come Scorio. Hear that little tiny bit of those two eighth notes that she's the only one after the fermata. She sings them in time. Most people which is kind of annoying. I like the fact that she sings it kind of as written, although I understand why most people do it the other way. So we'll just do a little tiny, just so you can hear that. I think that something about that just stuck out to me. And now we're going to move on to some full, complete studio recordings. And who will be the first? A soprano known for this role did it quite a lot. I'll talk about her in a moment, and then we'll talk about another soprano that had a little relation to Phyllis Curtin, who we just heard. And so from our first studio recording, not one of my favorite sopranos, I don't hate her or anything, but Elisabeth Schwarzkopf, and she was a celebrated Mozartian, or at least this role in particular, Fiordaligi, and the Countess, and of course her Marshall and Strauss were some of her key roles that she was celebrated for. And like I said, it's just not my favorite sound. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's the detachment of it. Maybe it's the Germanic quality of it. I'm not sure. But anyway, the rest of the cast is fabulous, and she sounds quite good on this anyway. Christa Ludwig is the Dorabella. Krauss, Alfredo Krauss is the tenor, so not a bad recording. Karl Böhm is conducting, so here we have a little Betty Blackhead. Flat was, whew, it was a little spot on, but just and so there, the Elisabeth Schwarzkopf, and we'll move on to somebody else, but I had to play her because she was in my lineup of stuff, right? Next up, we have an English version from the Metropolitan Opera with Eleanor Staber singing this role. And I was going to mention that a couple moments ago about Phyllis Curtin. I don't know if they actually shared the role, but Phyllis did do this at the Metropolitan quite a bit. And so I'm assuming it was in the same production. I don't know if they were in the same season. I'd have to look that up. But they both did do this role. And I don't know if the Metropolitan did this English version when they performed it. I think it, from what I remember, it was just kind of a shtick for them to record in English. I think when they did the performances, they were in Italian. I could have that wrong. I will have to look it up. But anyway, Eleanor Staber, and I will play the recit just because it's in English, and it's in the Ruth and what are their names here? You know, the Ruth and Thomas Martin translation, which is has become quite dated. Although I will say that Mozart in particular works very well in translation. I will say it always drives me crazy when American or English speakers over enunciate and say things that you wouldn't normally say. I mean, she was pushing those T's at the end, and then fortune. Who says fortune? Fortune. Who says fortune? And she said, it's fortune. Come on. But anyway, Eleanor Staber. I don't listen to a lot of her because she didn't do a ton of commercial recordings. But of course, she has that great Boston connection because she went to New England Conservatory. So she's sort of a iconic New England, Boston in particular, soprano. I like the tempo. So wouldn't be my first choice, but a glorious voice nonetheless, and it's just kind of fun to hear it in English. And people like Roberta Peters and Richard Tucker, and I mean you can't get better than that. But once again, it's in English, so you know if you see this, it's kind of maybe your second or third choice. Just saying. Next up, we have the glorious New Zealand soprano, Kira Te Kanawa. She did this role quite a bit, if I remember correctly. And the other singers on here are not too bad either. Von Stada, Teresa Stratus is the Despina. Oh, and by the way, before I forget, Stratus is the Despina on the film version with Gruborova. And she steals that whole movie, by the way. And so anyway, here's a little Kira Te Kanawa. A little too soft for my taste. And I like the tempo to be a little faster. I love that American English version. So lovely. Not bad on the low note either. I mean, it's just such a beautifully creamy sound. But I do wish the tempo were a little faster and that she had a little more bite to it. It's a little too pretty. And next up is a particularly fun version. And here we have another wonderful American soprano, the glorious Leontine Price. And this is just a fantastic recording. Leinsdorf conducting, Tatiana Troyanos as the Dorabella, George Shirley as the tenor, and just wonderful, wonderful vocalism. And it reminds me of there's a recital of hers from I think Lincoln Center where she does all sorts of great stuff. I think she even does, she does the final scene from Salome. And she does this. I don't know if it's the very opening one, but she does this, and she does this great bit on the high B flat where she does a little ornament that nobody else does, and that's why I love it. Well, nobody else except for well, you'll I'll explain that in a moo in a maybe in the next video. Once again, a little too slow. Love that sound. I couldn't remember if she did it on this recording, and she does. So that's what I was talking about, and that's what she does on that live from I think it's Lincoln Center recital that she does. She does that wonderful little flourish. So we got to hear that again. Surprised more people don't do that. I just think that it's a fantastic spot for it. There's a fermata. Why not? And after all those other versions, we finally get to something that's at least a little more unique as far as that goes. And so I have one last one, believe it or not. Just one more. Just indulge me one more time. And so to finish up and round out the afternoon of Quasi and this glorious aria, if you're not too, if you've made it this far, and this is I saved it for last because it's probably my favorite recording, and it has Felicity Lott and Marie McLaughlin and Nuccia Fucile and Jerry Hadley and then Alessandro Corbelli and then that a long French name that I can't Gilles Cachanaille. I'm just totally off on that. He's a bass. I mean, I don't know those names. But anyway, Jerry Hadley, of course, who passed away far too young, who took his own life. But Felicity Lott has always been one of my faves. I don't think I've really mentioned her. She reminds me of someone like Yvonne Kenny, and it's that type of voice that I've used before where I say it's very completely and wholly feminine, and I always mean that as such a supreme compliment. There's a Mozart all aria disc that conducted by Jane Glover, which is just fabulous. And so anyway, Felicity Lott as with her version of Come Scoglio. And I have to mention. Let me stop that for a second, and we'll start that over. I have to mention this is Charles Mackaras conducting, and this is well, it came out a little while ago. See if I can find the date on this. But it was it's of the newer types in that they allow some ornamentation and some appoggiatura. 1994, so it's still getting up there in age, but. It's fun and exciting to hear it done a little differently with some ornamentation and appoggiatura where you don't normally hear it. You hear it in the recitative, but not always in the aria proper, where she just did one just at the very, very beginning, which, like I said, you can hear the difference right off the bat. See what I mean? It's an upper appoggiatura. I love that. So, once again, a little different in those upper appoggiatura. Come escolio, instead of come escolio, or come escolio, she does come escolio. I love that. Just a little different. So, I guess now we have to hear the whole rest of the aria, right? Ornament. That's what I'm talking about. Triplets. Love that. And so thank you for indulging me in all those other openings and the recits and just the first few phrases of the aria. I know it was a lot to get to. And then, of course, the best part is the rest of the aria. But what I really wanted to do was to pique your interest in a bunch of other sopranos and to see there's just so many amazing variations just in my little stack of 13 sopranos singing that aria. And so, sorry, this was quite a much lengthier than I anticipated. But I'm glad to be back and glad to be doing these videos again. Until next time, Tim Ostendorf, baritone and innkeeper from the Innit Crystal Lake in Eaton, New Hampshire. That's www.innitcrystallake.com. We'll see you next time. All right.